Hello, so the game has three major parts to it. Now, I will do them in a certain order. First, the overworld map and the legion stuff and all of that, then the camp upgrades and all of the systems in the camp, and then finally the character upgrades, skills, armors, and a lot of other stuff. Now, the most important thing you need to know is that the game is kind of based on what you do to your legion, because if you don't expand fast enough, you don't capture resources fast enough, you'll have a very slow grind, and if you're playing on, let's say, normal, that will not be so bad, but if you're playing on hard or insane, it will be a very, very big problem. Now, always press Alt to highlight all of the objectives. Now, let's go over all of these and what they do. For example, the Observatory. You might think, well, it's useless, no? It has a chance to reveal new loot caches around the area, which might contain good armor and some other things, so be sure to check them out. The Legion mission, here is where you send your Legion, but you will sometimes spend Denarii, as you can see, the reward can be 5 between 10 slaves, which is super, super important. So try to send your legion on missions when you're not capturing anything, when you're not doing anything with that, so it doesn't really, you know, sit idly. Now, about the... Well, the hunting ground is kind of good for supplies, but again, don't waste their time, because each time they do a thing, they do a mission, they will actually lower their morale. What is morale? Well, morale is important for legion strength. As you can see, minus 7 morale means that the army strength is 2930, even though we have 3000 manpower. So if you have 100 morale, that will be 4000 strength. And that will become much more important later on, where you will be fighting a lot of armies. So even though you will be winning most of your battles, you need to keep your casualties to the minimum. Otherwise, you have to replace your troops, your legion troops, with Denarii. Experience, well, just fight a lot, what can I say, not much to that. And now, another thing you should know is that to conquer a sector, you need to conquer the campsite to get the... Well, it's actually pretty easy to see what the campsite is, or the center of the sector. This one is over here, as you can see, that's for the story, you will not be able to conquer it. So you also need to scout, because you need to conquer neighboring sectors. Now, the problem is sometimes, well, you'll need to go back to your campsite to do stuff and other things, so don't wander too far away. Also, your legion can actually be moved from one zone to another. Sometimes you'll even get an attack. For example, if you have two swords crossed over here, that means this sector will get attacked. It's actually very, very small to see how where the attack is. So if this sector has two swords, you can click on it and then you can select your legion to send it back, but in this case it's actually defended by another one. Click on the specific outpost or the campsite, then send your legion. And then you'll see over here an attack. You'll see it over here, which is kind of bad. Also, you can increase this speed, of course. So, crafting finished. Let's go over the icons, manpower, recover, rations, consume. So be very careful about your rations, because later on, if you use them too much or if you sell them, you'll actually be kind of left empty. Over here we have our slaves, which are the most important resource in the game, because without them you cannot conquer the various resources. The first thing you should conquer is of course an iron mine, so you can build armory. Medicine, well, you need a lot of medicine. This is actually a thing most people kind of disregard. But as you go further into the game, you'll need to kind of, you know, swap some of your resources for money or some other things to increase your legion strength. So yeah, be very careful, because if you lose a lot of manpower, a lot of soldiers, you'll need to use your Denarii to kind of recruit new ones, which means you'll have less money for unique items and some other stuff. Okay, another thing is that you can travel alongside your legion. So for example, you can send your legion over here and you can go to the observatory. Also, certain locations have better rewards, so if you want to fight the enemy in this tannery, you'll also get 25 slaves and 50 Denarii, which is super, super important. So be sure to check out all of the locations for the best loot, so you can fight the strongest armies with your strongest legion. So yeah, it will be a little harder, and later on you'll actually control two legions, after that you'll control one legion, but it will be stronger. So make sure you keep everything in check regarding army strength, and, you know, upgrade your stratagems. Now, after you conquer the sector, you have your legion over there, and then you have conquered an iron mine, which again should be the first thing you do, because if you don't, you won't have enough slaves to conquer it. So yeah, careful. Let's enter the legion camp and speak about the other systems over here. Of course, there are a lot of things to say. I'll probably do other videos with tips and tricks and some explanations, but for now that's enough. I think most people will kind of get the idea of the game, but they'll miss on the finer points because they're not explained anywhere. And some people will actually believe that the Legion strength is independent from the moral and some other stuff anyway. But people don't understand why they have such a weak Legion even though they have a lot of people. Also depends on stratagems that you unlock later. So this guy over here
Legate.
Is the guy that will make the improvements. As you can see, the armory must be your first building. No question about it. Independent of the difficulty, this should be your first one. The other ones can be interesting and, you know, they can refresh your tactical items, which can give you a lot of supplies and... Well, again, it's not for now, it's for later, because you cannot build supplies in the beginning. And this one, Palisades, no, not really. You will not get attacked that much, you don't really need a buff and some of the other things. Unless you are playing a very specific way and know what you're doing. So armor will be first, and then the major another major upgrade will be the forge. Since you'll be able to craft a lot of other things. So again, iron mine, you will need a lot of them. And some farms and tanneries. So all his work towards getting the next upgrade, for example the workshop, it will be the next thing I want to unlock because, well, we'll need the stratagems. Without the stratagems you lose again more manpower. So armory, workshop, then probably stockpile, probably emporium, better exchange range, so we can exchange our supplies like the medicine and the food supplies for denarii and stuff like that. And probably the walls, and then I'll probably go for forge, and maybe then I'll consider some of these ones. So all is conquer all of the sectors, all of the production facilities in a sector. Don't live without them, because you'll not be able to get all of your camp upgrades. Over here is the trader. Now, this is a bit of a weird thing. For example, denarii is considered a resource, so remember that, always remember. So, if you want to sell one of your slaves, it will be 100 denarii, right? But if you want to buy a slave, it will be 225, okay? If you give them denarii, right? If you give them medicine, let's say 9 medicine is 1 slave, but also 9 medicine is 153 denarii. So based on the exchange rate, for example, this resource is abundant. So based on your area and what you're doing right now and the prices, for example, the slaves are scarce right now, so I don't recommend you buy them with denarii. I recommend you trade your, let's say, your rations or a bit of your medicine for the slaves. Depending on what the price is and what the fluctuation is. Also, for selling, don't sell resources when this is low, because you only mostly use them for recovering your soldiers and to buy some rare and special gear. But yeah, probably need to upgrade this and kind of be very careful with that one, because that can ruin your game if you just spend too many resources or if you run out of food or medicine or slaves.
Please, excuse me.
So plan ahead. Now, this is where you recruit people, and this is what, again, we'll spend a bit of time over here because there are a lot of finer points to this. Now, you might think, well, what's the best one? Well, I can tell you this, don't get hesitant or... Maybe indifferent is okay, but disgruntled and hesitant is kind of bad for you. As you can see, there are 150 each. So, what should you recruit for your main commanders and your Praetorian guards? This is your Praetorian party, which means it's your B team, meaning it's the people you send to die. But some missions will require you to send only one of your commander, one of your centurions, one of your main companions as they're called. And then you have to send them with four Praetorians. So be very careful. You need to give them gear. You need to look at their level and their abilities. So buy, let's say, four Princeps, two Sagittarius, and maybe two Triarius or... Well, it depends on what you want. And also what you find, because in the beginning it will be very hard to find them. Now, what are the best skills? There is no such thing as a best skill. Try to get someone with crafty. You need an architect, but that will be a little later when you unlock certain things. And I found that the best commander, well, the best commander is a Veles with infantry and aggressivity. Looks like he'll also get a lot of positive things. For example, he will not have a chance to fail the mission. He'll also kind of get better loot sometimes. The other ones, well, they're not so important. I don't think the Medicus is so good, the Triarius. And probably logistics is the thing that gets used a lot more in the combat itself. Now, probably infantry will also get used. So, I think a better combination would be logistics plus infantry, infantry specialization, but you'll not find it. I don't think it's very easy to find. So, in combat, for attack and defense purposes, they are considering their class and also their specialization. For example, cautious will mean the fight will take a lot longer, but again, let's not get into the finer points or the finer details. Just know that, for example, reckless paired with infantry specialization is great. If he has freeloader, that means you can assign him to your tent. This would be a better choice, probably. But he's a Sagittarius, so he'll probably be very good at attacking. Super, super aggressive, super good. But if the enemy is a little, has a sizable force, that means you'll lose more. So again, it depends on a lot of things. But from what I can see, infantry specialization, logistics, and Veles are kind of like the ones that get used the most. Otherwise, I would probably get him as a commander. Let's actually see. Do I want to... How many chariots do I have? One. I guess one is enough. Princeps, princeps, three princeps. Yeah, princeps are the best. Four. Sagittarius, one chariots. Maybe I should get another Veles. No. It's kind of upset with me anyway. So let's dismiss him because I don't want to see his upset face. Praetorian, Centurion. So that will be a Centurion. That means there's the slot they occupy. So remember, you can dismiss some of them and then recruit them back. So they're interchangeable. Also, the more you play and the more you level up, the better the level will be. So I bought these guys for 100 dinari, but they're also tier 3 only. So yeah, we'll see how good this guy is because look at this. He can level up his logistics, his cavalry, infantry, plus aggressiveness. I guess he'll be my best commander. He's also pleased. So yeah, that's again, that's probably a long explanation, but over here, I recommend you always put someone with the recruiting trait. These are the traits, or the perks, depends on how you want to call them. Always put someone over here so it refreshes your recruits, because they can be between 1 and 6 with this guy. Also, you'll need someone at the armory. Crafty, which will be super good. You can also change them around apparently, which will modify the times a little bit. Huh, 16, 19, well I guess you can see the difference. The difference is a few hours, but sometimes 3 hours for a single item means 15 hours for 5 items and so on. F-House Workshop, this will be super super important later on. Also the Speculator Rest and again important, so... Some of these guys, the B team, or the Praetorians, will have to occupy these roles. So try to have one that crafts, one that has the Architect, and of course Speculatores, which will probably... The Scavenger is nice, but you probably want the one with two little grenades. Let me go and check if we have anything. So try to recruit your Praetorians based on their skills for the camp and based on their skills as commanders, but also based on their fighting capacity or their fighting skills. Increase the number of free tactical item replenishment by one when assigned to our tent. Freeloader also. Oh, Scavenger. He's a Scavenger and a Freeloader. That's actually super important. I think I'll just... I'll have to fire one of the Sagittarius. I think he's the one that I'm using in combat. Let me check. Yeah, they just refreshed and I want to change them because later on you want to future-proof it. I think this guy was actually used in combat because he has the Interrupt and the Vigilant, okay. Okay, let's dismiss him. Also, the UI is very, very silly sometimes. Also, quick save before you do anything. Just in case, you know, you might have a little bit of a problem with your decision making. So, he is also level 4. I guess the combat capabilities don't matter that much. These skills are super nice to have. Probably using a lot of items. Again, at certain points of the game, certain mechanics will become useless, like this one. But for now, I'll just have him in my party because I was not really using the other archer. I don't recommend you fight with more than one archer. Well, this is not so important, but let's go over this one as well. It is where you can change your trophies. I think later you'll have access to more stuff, but for now this is kind of it. You can also speak with this guy.
Our way, Lagat. Morale has been better. I believe if we're not at full strength.
He'll kind of give you some answers. For example, the full strength is 4,800, and I think it can be bigger later on. This is where you can kind of view everything. I think this is your tent. You can also modify your colors, your emblems, and your trophy. I like the Aquila. Assignments. Yes, outpost management. You can select your upgrades and stuff like that. And kind of like, sometimes you'll have characters over there. This is where you have your prisoners, Archelaus. And that kind of covers the camp management in the beginning. Oh, also, I almost forgot. This is where you'll find your items. The items that you craft will be in the box over here next to Sextus.
A bunch fine.
And he'll also teach you a lot of useful mechanics. Your companions will be here and there. Also, try to speak with all of them and exhaust their options, because sometimes you'll get an option to do something interesting. Why are you selecting that already? Okay, now this is the harder part of the game. How should I start? Well, okay, let's start with crafting, basic crafting. You might think, why do I need to craft stuff? Well, for example, if you have someone new in your team, you might want to craft them an item. For example, the Lori Kahamata. This is probably one of the better starter armors you can craft, and it's also regular salvage. That means it's very, very cheap to craft, very fast to craft. So, movement only -2, our resistance 5-8, and 1 armor. Compare it to the Lorica Musculata, which might have 2 armor, but yeah, that movement penalty will mean it's almost impossible to use, plus the heavy armor plate. So don't try to craft a lot of the expensive items or items that are kind of harder to use in the beginning. Try to craft things that will be almost universal for everyone, like this one. As for the weapons themselves, probably the Gladios are nice, but to be honest, sometimes I just prefer the Sifos. This is also a pretty good dagger with focus per attack. Some helmets can also be super nice as well. As you can see, this one can have armor. And the more things you unlock, the more you can craft. The items you can craft will be here, probably. I think you can... Well, they will be over here, so sometimes you'll just have to read the blueprints. Also, materials are over here, tactical talismans and stuff like that. Now, how do you get the salvage? Well, the salvage is easy to get. You just hold right click. Sadly, this means sometimes you lose some items. It's not your intention, but to be honest, just preserve anything that's pristine or above. And this is Kaisos Olgale, worn heavy helmet. So, the ones you really, really want to keep are the unique ones. Even though it says worn, this is a character item. The character's items are super important, because if you disassemble them, you'll get a plume. That is an item, so you can craft it at a better tier. For example, all of the tiers are 1 right now. It says Aspis 1, Pugio 1, Sifos 2. So yeah, this is a tier 2 item, and as you can see, it has a lot more power to it. Well, if it's worn, you can destroy it without any problems. Also, Kaisos or Musculata will be recrafting it in a better version. And I think if you go to Egypt, all of the items will switch to tier 2, and in Gaul, it will be tier 3. Again, I'm not sure about that, but that's how kind of it works. Sometimes you are able to craft them at a higher tier. For example, what do I mean by that? Her armor was, of course, disassembled, and then you recrafted it, and it had a special thing. So, most of your characters will have special gear that after you decraft and craft again will give them certain great things. And this is the plume. Without the plume you cannot craft it. So, right now we can craft it and it will have this. This item belongs to Kaisa. I think that means you can only equip on that character. You inflict a critical hit, forcing them to attack you next turn. Sure. We'll craft it. Also his musculata. That means, well, it will give him shield strength and some other stuff. Prevents all more allies. Well, guess it will be useful later, but as you can see, we need pristine salvage. And that's kind of all of the things I wanted to craft. So, decraft all of the legendary items or the unique items or items that belong to characters and reassemble them. Now, yeah, you might want to destroy the regular stuff just for the items, but keep some in reserve because you might get new people. Now, some other super important things. Well, you have the bandage, and I guess I can give you the water jug. Another very, very important thing about them is their skills. So certain items, even though they're practically the same, might give you different skills. This is more true for the weapons themselves. For example, this weapon will give you... He has a Sifos. Let me see if I have other Sifos. Okay. So this Sifos will give you 3 skills, right? E, to see the skills. Defensive Strike, which is great because it will apply Deflect on you. That means you hit them once, you have a Deflect, and you also have your shield. That means you need to be hit 2 times in order to get damage. Piercing. 9 to 12 damage. Compare this to the Gladius. 4 to 6. It's about the different skills you can get, but... Defensive Strike can be also found over there. You cannot crit, but crit is not so important in the beginning because you will not have access to things that increase your crit. So try to max out your damage. Also have the slash, which is great because the Sifos, this particular one has the slash and also the lunge. As you can see, the damage is lower, but you also hit more people. Now, what about the shield? Well, to be honest, just look at this. Shield crash, you do 6 to 11 bludgeoning damage. You need to have one shield and it will remove the shield, but yeah. Also, the skills themselves determine the type of damage. For example, defensive strike is slashing, lunge is piercing. The shield attack is bludgeoning, so basically I have all 3 types of damage with him. So if an enemy is particularly resistant to bludgeoning, you can just use your slashing attack. If it's piercing, then use your piercing. And so on. This will become important much later into the game, but for now just know that the weapons themselves are not important, it's what skills they bring you. Sifos 2. Gouge. This will remove the stacks of bleeding, which is kind of bad because you cannot inflict bleeding with this character. I don't like that skill at all, but we also have the lunge on this one, and that's 10 to 13, plus the pommel strike. The pommel strike is one of the rarer skills. Provokes an attack of opportunity. But it also applies stunned to enemies. So, if he has a shield, that means he can block it, or you can use defensive strike again. You can have a lot of combinations of skills. But you can probably see what are my choices based on the damage and what they do. Yeah, even though Gouge doesn't look like a good one, at least it does a little bit of... I mean, it does regular damage and it also has a skill. So probably if you can inflict bleeding with your archer and then go with your other guy, it will be okay. Let's have a second. Okay, do I need to? Okay, let's look at the Veles as well, the Veles build. Now, the spear. The spear is pretty important because look at this. Piercing damage and apply strong to self. That's not important. But the important one is Humiliating Slash. It reduces the target's morale by 20. So if you hit someone, you reduce their morale by 20. And then you use this guy's skills. Frightened. That's almost like cheating because you can make the enemy panic and attack each other and a lot of other nonsense. So look at these things as well. Don't only look at the stats or if they do enough damage. Look also for some, you know, unique combos into interaction. He also has the spear charge, which is of course plus 10% damage for every hex you move. Moving 3 hexes or farther will apply 2 stacks of bleeding. So what does that mean? So you'll apply the bleeding, which doesn't go away on its own, so that means 2 stacks of bleeding. Which means 6 more damage, which means 11 to, I don't know, 14 damage or more. Probably he can also crit and stuff like that, so suddenly this skill becomes super good as well. For the Pugia, well, probably the flank is good. So what does flanking mean? Flanking means the character is engaged in combat and you are behind them. It's kind of like the same system for War Tales, I think. So yeah, backstab can be super good. Also, you can check the other daggers for what they do. Applies 2 stacks of bleeding to the target and stuff like that. But again, the damage is a little lower. 2 to 4, 3 to 7 plus critical damage and some other stuff. So it's kind of hard to choose the daggers, but you know, just go for the highest damage and some utility if you cannot. As for your archer, well, the Eurypteus bow that I was crafting is the best one probably in the whole game. Probably, if you upgrade it and give it some other stuff, it will be great. As for this guy, always keep a staff on him. You might think, well, why a staff? Because he's not so good. No, a staff is super good. Because he can also attack 2 hexes away, it shreds armor, it can also apply weaken to enemies, so yeah. This guy will also be super important to be kind of like your backline. If you play Battle Brothers, yeah, he's the backline. So, for example, these guys will use their skills like knockdown, or just, you know, defending against strikes and destroying their shield or their block. And then this guy will come from behind and he will use his skills to either apply weak, destroy their armor, or to just hit them, or to even do certain things. For example, I gave him the death blow, so they knock down, he comes in for the kill and stuff like that. So it's kind of like protecting your weaker classes that have more utility on them. That's kind of like the whole tactics. As for the armor and stats, I'll do other videos to show you. Now, if you're wondering what their traits are, these are the traits, what they like, what they don't like, and also their perks. Some of them have very interesting things like Recruiter, but if you leave him in the tent, you'll not be able to take part in our mission, so don't leave any companions at the camp. The skills, you can also get Physician for him. It's quite an easy quest, Agreeable, Constitution, Princeps, and this is you, Logos. So you kind of get what you get a bit of a short roundup. I wish this was present in more places, the shield strength, the movement, health, and armor. Go over to inventory, you also see the same thing, but also the resistances, so yeah. It can be quite overwhelming in the beginning, but don't worry, you will handle it. Oh, okay. So we're crafting unique sword for the Archelaus unique sword and some other stuff as well. Now, I'll only show you what the sword looks like after you craft it again, because it was super weak when I first got it. Sorry about all of the boring talk, but I guess if you want the short version, this is it. If you want the longer version, it might take even more based on what mechanics you really want to learn better. So yeah, between missions of your legion, you just recover your strength, the strength of your legion, and do some missions, find some items, craft some items. You don't have enough time to do everything, so yeah. Let's go outside. Put it on 3. Press space. Manpower recovered. Sadly, there is no way to wait in your camp, which is kind of like an oversight from the developers, but I guess I understand why they do it. Okay, now let's go and recover some of those items, and the first time you get the unique items, you think they're trash, and you might want to throw them away, but don't throw them away, and most importantly, don't forget about them. And they will be over here. 6 to 8, 4 to 6. Yeah, so I think the legendary weapons, after you decraft them and craft them again, if they are still tier 1, you might get better stats, the secondary stats, extra piercing and base damage maximum. That's actually a little better, I think. Reduce piercing damage, extra slashing damage. Oh man, that's kind of bad. But again, this armor is super good. So yeah, this should be kind of like your priority, recrafting the armor for your companions. This one is kind of good as well, yes? But there's no way you can compare that to this one. Focus maximum or resistance is 5, movement minus 2 plus 1 health. Plus his special ability, now it also looks very cool on him. Okay, the good thing is that this weapon has only slashing skills. That gouge skill is super bad. But the Good thing is that all slashing damage applies the bleeding status to your target, which deals damage every turn. So, yeah, it can gouge, but it also applies the bleeding. So, not sure I want it. I mean, yeah, the pommel strike is super nice, and this one has the deflect, the offensive strike, which is again super nice. So I guess this will remain over here. Also, you can give them two weapons, pressing Q, but if you give them a weapon, well, they might be unable to have their skills, so you can go to open skill selection and select their skills. So don't forget to give them the first aid or the soothe pain skill if they're a medic. As far as she has a spear, of course, which is a very good spear. Extra piercing damage, accuracy and critical damage. This will hurt a lot. Let's look at the skills. So, Interrupt will do 10 to 16. That's pretty huge. Also the rebook, because later on you can get a powerful kick, which will knock down enemies. So you can knock down enemies with your archer. Okay, let's go over the classes. Wow. Okay, let's go over fast because you... Well, let's just start for the beginning. For the Princeps, the Veteran is of course the best one because you want them to move relatively easy. You also want them to knock down. Super, super important. Opportunist and some of the other stuff is not so important. But again, Headbutt... You can apply Weakened or Herdor with your Archer or with your... You can also apply it, of course, based on his skills or his weapon. Yeah, Weakened. So that's probably the first things you should take on him, these three skills. Platin is also very, very good. The other ones, again, they're a bit... Depends on where you are in the game. Later on, you'll need also this one... Health upgrade. If it's a square, it's an active skill that might have charges. If it's round, that means it's a passive one. Plus one to press damage when the shield is equipped. That might be better later on. Also, Warcry will be interesting to use. Immovable. Might be interesting to use. Apply standing thrust to allies, immune to cripple stun. Okay. Yeah. What about the Triarus? Well, the Triarus basically needs a few things from the flag bearer. The medic is nice, but again, you'll not get a lot of, how should I put it, a lot of value from him. So, probably death blow from your Triarus will be great. Maybe armor shed if you're finding people with a lot of armor. The quick lunge can also be pretty good. And then you should probably go into flag bearer, because restored action point when ally who spend theirs might be super, super important. Even though it seems like, hey, it costs one use... I mean, think about it. If your ally dies, what? Does 20 damage and is also a tank, he can go and sit near an archer or something like that. Warhorn, rallied. 25% extra damage. Bolstered. The character cannot fail morale checks. Super important. And then you have the ruse, which means enemies move out of that area. You can apply fire and do a lot of other cool stuff with them. Orator, inspire now resets the target's cooldowns as well. Yeah, it'll be super important later on. Embarrassing ruse, morale damage, rousing speech. Restore 25% health to all allies, super good. As for the fairies, well, I guess it mostly depends on you. The assassin class is one of the things I like because you can go and kill the leader super fast. Marathon and some of the other stuff are super good as well. So Marathon and yeah, Assassinate plus Sneak Action plus a lot of other things can make it very, very easy for you to kill bigger units or bigger or stronger, very, very strong enemies. 50% increased damage to targets with full health. So yeah, you can basically one-shot a lot of character and do a lot of other cool stuff with Assassin. The problem is mostly for moving around and I don't think it's that good. Depends on where you are, but probably Assassin is the best one to choose in the beginning since you want to kill certain enemies like archers, leaders, very heavy armored opponents. He also has the spear, which I think he can shred armor depending on the spear itself and the skills. But bleeding is pretty good as well. Sagittarius, of course, marksman. Don't even need to tell you why. Steady hands. So yeah, steady hands, that means you can crit a few times, and with that bow you can basically crit indefinitely enemies that approach you. So yeah, Definitely the best believe, and it will be a little more defensive. And with Overwatch, you can also make them attack. You can attack the ones that only do attacks. Of course, I mentioned powerful kick and some of the other stuff. So yeah, that's basically the whole classes, the gear, the armor, everything you kind of needed to know. Sniper might be seem like a good idea, but remember later on, the maps will be kind of short, so enemies will kind of be always one turn away from you. So don't go into sniper or hunter because, I mean, there are arguments for each of the skills and the classes, but like I said, that's probably the more efficient way to play it, and you'll see for yourself. Anyway, see you next time. Bye.